Friends, in the previous two videos, we discussed about the formation and properties of steel. Now, I would like to go further, that is the processes of vapors, thermodynamic processes of vapors and steam calorimeters. Thermodynamic processes of vapors. This I am going to briefly touch because of the scarcity of time. I am going to briefly touch it. Thermodynamic processes of vapors. Now, in thermal, basic thermodynamics, in semester, fourth semester, we have studied thermodynamic processes of gases. Now, here the working substance, there was a gas, here it is vapor, and thermodynamic process means the same thing. If we heat, cool, expand or compress, if we do any one of these four things, then you say that the vapor has, vapor means it is only steam which is taken here, it is said to have undergone a thermodynamic process. Similar to that, what we did in the previous, in the previous semester, here also we have a number of thermodynamic processes. They are constant volume process, then constant pressure process, then constant temperature or isothermal process, then we have adiabatic or isentropic process. Before this we have hyperbolic process, which is not there in gases, hyperbolic process, then adiabatic, or it is also called as isentropic process, then we have polytropic process, then we have throttling process and loss we have throttling process, then free expansion process. Right, these are the important thermodynamic processes of vapors, that is thermodynamic processes of steel. Now, as in the case of the gases, this process means here anything else can change except the volume of steam. So here V2 is equal to V1. Now the first thing that we will have to find out is from here, what is the final condition of steam? So for that, what we do is, therefore X2 VG2 is equal to X1 VG1. Normally P1 is given, so VG1 you will get from the steam table. X1 is given in the problem. VG2 we can find out from the steam table because P2 is also given. So what we do not know is X2. So X2 will be equal to X1 VG1 divided by VG2. This will give you the value of X2, that is the final condition of steam. Again here W is 0. Now delta U will be U2 minus U1. So Q is same as delta U, that is same as U2 minus U1 because W is 0. So these are the formulae which come in this process. In this process, you have to find out, first you have to find out X2, because without knowing X2, without knowing the final condition, we will not be able to get U2, that is the final internal energy. So these are the this thing. Here it will be P1 is equal to P2, that is no change in pressure. So they will give both X1 and X2 will be given. Here they will ask us to find out W. W will be equal to 100 P into 100 P Vg. 100 P Vg. 100 P Vg into X2 minus X1. So many kilojoules per kg. Delta U will be U2 minus U1. And then Q will be this plus that. That will be H2 minus H1. We can prove that it is equal to H2 minus H1. Now, in this constant temperature process, you get the temperature remains constant here. So, T sub 2 will be equal to T sat 1. T sub 2 will be equal to T sat 1. So, delta H will be equal to H2 minus H1. Delta S is equal to S2 minus S1. Q will be equal to capital T sat 1 into delta S. So many kilojoules per kg. These are the formulae that you will have to know. In hyperbolic process, here P2 V2 is equal to P1 V1. The law of expansion or compression is PV is equal to constant. So from this equation you can get X2. X2 will be equal to P1 X1 VG1 divided by P2 VG2. This will give you X2. Then you will have to find out W. W will be 100 P1 X1 VG1 into X1 VG1 into log of X2 VG2, that is V2 by V1 to base E. So many kilojoules per kg. Delta U will be equal to U2 minus U1. That is same as H2 minus H1. And Q will be equal to W plus delta U. So these are the formulae that you have to know in hyperbolic process. In adiabatic process, here heat is neither absorbed nor rejected during the expansion. No heat is either absorbed or rejected as in the case of gases. It is called isentropic process because in this process entropy will be constant. Because entropy is constant, this is called isentropic process. So if entropy is constant, S2 is equal to S1. S2 is equal to S1. So X2 can be got like this. X2 will be equal to S1 minus SF2 whole thing divided by SFG2. This will give you X2. Here Q is 0, so W is same as minus delta U, that is W will be equal to U1 minus U2, U1 minus U2 kilojoules per kg. That is the formula that you get in adiabatic process. In polytropic process, again like in gases, here PV to the power of N is equal to constant. So X2 will be equal to P1 by P2 whole to the power of 1 by N into X1 VG1 divided by VG2. This formula will give you the value of X2. Then W will be equal to 100 into P1 X1 VG1 minus P2 X2 VG2 divided by n minus 1. That will be the formula for W, and delta U will be equal to U2 minus U1, and Q will be equal to W plus delta U. These are the formulae for polytropic process. I am doing it very fast so that I can cover it in the given time. Next, I hope you have noted it. Next, in throttling process, H will be constant. Here, no W, no Q, no delta U. All that will not be asked. Here, generally, what we will be asked to find is X2 will be equal to H1 minus HF2 divided by HFG2. If X1 is given, if X1 is asked, they will give X2, then it will be H2 minus HF1 by HFG1. That will give. Here, no problem will be asked. Free expansion means letting out the steam to atmosphere. If you, through a pipe, if you simply let it out to the atmosphere, then it is called as the free expansion process. Here, no work done, no work is done, no change in internal energy, and no heat transfer takes place. So these are the important processes. After this, you also have study of calorimeters, steam calorimeters. Steam calorimeters also is there. Now, a steam calorimeter is a device, is an equipment used to find or practically determine the steam calorimeters or instruments used in the laboratory to practically find out the dryness fraction of a given wet steam sample. That is called as a steam calorimeter. Now, in this, you will not get a numerical in steam calorimeters, but you get theory. They will ask you to explain one of the calorimeters with the help of a neat diagram, a neat sketch, explain the working of one type of calorimeter. There are four types of calorimeters. One is called the barrel, or it is also called as bucket type of calorimeter, bucket calorimeter. Second one is the separating calorimeter. Third one is the throttling, that process, throttling process. It can also be called as wire drawing, that is expanding the steam through a narrow passage. That is called as throttling process, throttling calorimeter. Or the fourth one is combined separating and throttling calorimeter. These are the four. This last one is the most accurate. This will give the most accurate result. These have got some disadvantages. In this barrel calorimeter, there should be a sufficient rise. You are letting into a water, known quantity of water at a known temperature. You are letting a known quantity of steam at a known pressure. Then the heat lost by steam is equal to heat gained by water. That is the principle used. But you are not going to get very accurate results here unless you pass a large quantity of steam into the water. In separating calorimeter, we mechanically separate the steam and moisture. We try to separate the moisture from the steam mechanically. But this is difficult. You cannot completely remove the moisture which is there. The steam which comes out of this calorimeter is supposed to be dry, but it will not be exactly dry. it will be very nearly dry, so you don't get accurate result. In throttling calorimeter, here the steel after throttling must at least become dry saturated. For that, it should be, the initial condition of steam should be very nearly dry. That is, if it is around 0.95, 0.96, above 0.95, then with this you can get accurate results. If it is less than that, say 0.7, 0.8, 0.9, something like that, then the steam may not become superheated or dry at the end of throttling. Then you are not going to get very accurate results. In this first, it will be passed through a separating calorimeter, then it will be throttled. So this is definitely going to become superheated after that throttling process, and you are going to get two dryness fraction here. One from this you are going to x1, from one from here you are going to get x2, then x will be equal to the product of x1 into x2. This gives you the dryness fraction of the steam which is passing through the calorimeter. So this is in brief, I have given you the brief, this thing you have to study it from some book, or in the YouTube there may be animated videos given by some other authors. Those they may show you practically these working of these calorimeters. You will have to go through it and learn it. I have done it, a brief account of that is given. I hope you have understood this. You please like, share, comment and subscribe this channel so that we can produce more videos like this. I am going to give the formula for these processes which I wrote here. I am going to give it in a tabular column so that you can remember that. So first process, then formula for calculating x2 final condition, then formula for W, that is work done during the process, then delta U, that is change in internal energy, and then Q, that is heat transferred, any other miscellaneous formula. Now the first process is constant volume process. Here x2 will be equal to x1 vg1 divided by vg2. This is 0, this is u2 minus u1, this is also u2 minus u1, same as delta U because W is 0. This is the first one, I said wrong. Second one is constant pressure process. So here x2 we don't have to find out, that will be given. W will be 100 PVG into x2 minus x1, and delta U will be u2 minus u1, and this will be h2 minus h1. Then third one, constant temperature process or isothermal process. Here x2 you don't get, here W will be Q minus delta U, delta U will be U2 minus U1, U2 minus U1, here Q will be Tsat1 into S2 minus S1, those are the formulae. Then fourth one, hyperbolic process, that is PV is equal to constant, x2 is equal to p1 x1 vg1 divided by p2 vg2. W will be 100 p1 x1 vg1 into log of v2 by v1 to base e. This will be h2 minus h1, and this will be w plus delta u. Then adiabatic or isentropic process here x2 will be equal to s1 minus sf2 divided by sfg2. W will be, q will be 0 here, delta u will be u2 minus u1, w will be u1 minus u2. Sixth, polytropic process here x2 will be equal to p1 by p2 whole to the power of 1 by n into x1 vg1 divided by vg2. This will be 100 into p1 x1 vg1 minus p2 x2 vg2 divided by n minus 1. This will be u2 minus u1. This will be w plus delta u. Then these are the important processes, six important, very important processes. So these are the formulae. These are the relationships which you should remember.